on China, and also by the president of the university, yes, ladies and gentlemen. It's a really great pleasure for Faculty of Science to be able to host this lecture this afternoon. It's not every day that we get to shake hands in Thai, you say Kaptoprai, with Nobel laureate. But today is an exceptional day. We certainly most welcome Professor Kurt Burrish to come to the Faculty of Science. And judging from the audience, I think we certainly well received by our staff members as well as our guests. I would like firsthand to thank the International Peace Foundation, represented by Mr. Wu Wei, and Thai Pharma Bank, who has also co-organized this function. Without further delay, I would like to invite Professor Phuan Chai Mathakosongpai, President of Medon University, to deliver welcome as well as opening address for this special occasion. Professor Phuan Chai, please.
Thank you, Professor Murray. Professor Kurt Burrish, Mr. Uwe Morovich, Vice President Chanjira Buranawe from the Kasikorn Thai Bank, many deans and vice presidents of Medon University, and many guests here, and my colleagues, staff and students from Medon University. It's an honor for me to say a few words of welcome to our distinguished lecturer, who has come to be part of the Bridges and Dialogue lectures for peace. We are most grateful to the International Foundation for Peace and the Kasikorn Thai Bank for co-hosting this event. And we would like to welcome representatives from both the foundation and Kasikorn Thai Bank to this function. I also like to welcome many of our guests from outside Medon University to this lecture. And since the introduction is already too long, so I wouldn't say anything now except to welcome everyone. And I think everyone is waiting to hear from our lecturer, so I will welcome everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And now we have an honor of inviting Mr. Uwe Morovich, Chairman of the International Peace Foundation, to please give an address. Mr. Uwe, please.
Contribution to the Decade for Culture of Peace and Nonviolence. Initiated by the United Nations General Assembly, Thailand has been chosen as the host country for the event series Bridges, Dialogues Towards a Culture of Peace. Initiated by the International Peace Foundation, a non-political independent foundation, under the common patronage of the 21 Nobel Peace Prize laureates based in Vienna. Between November 2003 and April 2004, already more than 100 events took place with 10 Nobel laureates as well as other keynote speakers. And artists like Jesse Norman, who all came to Thailand without any fee or honorarium to promote the kingdom as a center for dialogue and international understanding. Her Royal Highness Princess Mahachakri Sirinthorn presided over several events, which in total reached an audience of 30,000 participants, including different target groups, thanks to a variety of partners, ranging from major universities and ministries to the Royal Thai Army, NGOs, businesses, media, and the diplomatic corps, which hosted the events in cooperation with the International Peace Foundation. After the completion of the first series of events, in a six-month intermission, the second and final series of Bridges with additional 150 events will be hosted in Bangkok, Chonburi, Chiang Rai, Chiang Mai, Kanchanaburi, Konkan, and Nakhon Ratchasima between December 2004 and April 2005. For this second series, and also final series, 18 Nobel laureates for peace, physics, chemistry, medicine and economics confirmed their participation, as well as other keynote speakers, including former UN Secretary General Boutros-Ghali and former UN Weapons Inspector Hans Blix. The pluralistic program of BRIDGES highlights the International Peace Foundation's intercultural and transdisciplinary approach towards peace. The foundation doesn't take sides, but acts as a mediator by creating an independent platform for dialogue where representatives of science, politics, economy, culture, religion, the media, and youth can meet, share their viewpoints, listen to each other, and find mutual ways of understanding and cooperation. สันติไม่อาจสร้างเครื่องได้ในเวลาอันสั้นแต่เป็นกระบวนการที่ต้องอาศัยเวลามูลนิธิจึงไม่ได้จัดกิจกรรมสร้างสัมพันธ์สู่สันติวัฒนธรรมเครื่องเทียนครั้งเดียวแต่เชิญผู้ได้รับรางวัลโนเบลและผู้นำของโลกร่วมกันสร้างสะพานเชื่อมสันติกับผู้นำของไทยจากทุกสาขาและประชาชนทั่วไปอย่างต่อเนื่องทั้งนี้ผู้ได้รับรางวัลโนเบลและปาฐกถีมาร่วมงานนี้ได้ทำสัญญาแล้วว่าแม้ จะสิ้นสุดโครงการท่านจะกลับมาอย่างประเทศไทยเป็นประจำเพื่อที่จะรักษาและประชับความสัมพันธ์กับสถาบันต่างๆและกับประเทศไทยให้ยั่งยืนมั่นคงต่อไปในวันนี้ผมขอขอบคุณศาสตราจารย์พรชัยมาทางกระทรวงพาณิชย์ธนาคารกสิกรไทยตลอดจนพันธมิตรและผู้ให้การสนับสนุนทุกราย I'm especially grateful to Professor Kurt Wittrich, who came to Thailand without any honorarium to support the events, and I now look forward to his keynote speech and his important contribution to build bridges. Thank you very much.
President of Mahidol University, Sastrajan Dr. Pornchai Mangpankha Sampat, Chairman of the Board of Directors, the International Peace Foundation, Mr. Uwe Morawit, distinguished guest. In celebration of humanity without borders and in admiration of Thailand as a peaceful country, Kasikorn Bank is proud to sponsor speeches by 17 Nobel laureates. For the next 5 months, each Nobel laureate will deliver his or her keynote addresses at various universities all over the country. As part of the International Peace Foundation's Bridges Towards a Culture of Peace project, on behalf of Kasikorn Bank, I am honored to present Professor Kurt Wittrich, Nobel laureate for chemistry in 2002. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I have with me 9-page printout of your autobiography. If I could go through that, that's the finish of your lecture. So I will not do that. But I did enjoy reading your printout from the website. Professor Kurt Wittrich was born, get this, October 4th, 1938 in Switzerland. He has his bachelor degree from the University of Bern and subsequently his PhD in chemistry from the University of Basel, Switzerland. In between there, there's a quote in there that I think it's intrigued to me. He said that studying natural science has always been a lot of fun for me. But nonetheless, my mind was quite solidly set on career as a high school teacher with a heavy involvement in sports. So a high school teacher becomes a Nobel Prize laureate. Subsequently, he went to a postdoctoral degree in Berkeley, University of California at Berkeley for 2 years. And during that time, another message came through from his autobiography. He said he was highly motivated by Bob Cornick's laboratory. Motivated by what? Motivated by weekly group seminars. this is something that I think stand out from his autobiography, that group seminars, coffee breaks, and things like this. This does stimulate people and motivate people quite a bit. After 2 years span as a postdoctoral at the University of California, Berkeley, between 1965 and 67, he went to Bell Telephone Laboratory in Murray Hill, New Jersey, USA. After 2 years there, he returned to Switzerland to work at ETH Missouri, where he has been there since. So he has been working with NMR for a number of years, and without doubt, the most expertise person with this piece of equipment. He also lately, not only working at ETH Zurich, he also becomes staff member at the Scripps Institute in La Jolla, San Diego, USA. I was asking him this morning what kind of percentage of time he is dividing himself between Switzerland, ETH, and La Jolla, Scripps, San Diego. He said each of the places take 100% of his time. So a Nobel that required twice as much time as a person have. So each of his day would have 48 hours instead of now normal 24 hours. So please welcome the 202 Nobel laureates in chemistry, Professor Kurt Woodbridge, on the topic of structure of the molecules of life, impact on modern biomedical research. Welcome.
Well, I would like to thank all of you for the warm welcome in Bangkok. This is the first time for me to interact professionally with colleagues in Bangkok, in Thailand. And I can say that after this first day of interaction at your university, I am very impressed to see what is evolving in Thailand in the biomedical and chemical sciences. I have not seen the other departments. I am certain that I would see as much encouragement there. My lecture today, I would like to start by giving you an impression of what kind of work we are doing in my laboratories in Switzerland and in the United States, in California. And the first two slides spell out the keywords that characterize our activities. So one keyword is NMR for nuclear magnetic resonance spectroscopy. Now this is a tool that we use to work in structural biology and in structural genomics. For those of you who are more inclined towards the medical clinical sciences, NMR spectroscopy is based on the same physical principle as magnetic resonance imaging that is widely used in medical diagnostic. And we have seen an MRI machine previously in the movie about the activities at your university. Now, structural biology is dominated by studies of the three-dimensional structure of proteins. And in addition to NMR, there is the technique of X-ray diffraction with protein crystals. This technique has been available to us for almost 50 years, the first successful use of X-ray diffraction with protein crystals was described by two colleagues, Max Perutz and John Kendrew, in 1957 to 1960. They determined the structures of hemoglobin and myoglobin and were awarded a Nobel Prize for this work in 1962, together with Watson and Crick, who at the time were awarded a prize in medicine for the proposal of the DNA double helix, together with Dr. Wilkins. The second technique that we use primarily in my laboratories, NMR, has been capable since about 20 years, since 1984, to provide structural information on proteins. And the big difference between the crystallographic method and the NMR method is that with NMR we can study proteins in solution. And I will come back to that in 2 or 3 minutes. Now let me first clarify what we are dealing with when we use these methods of protein three-dimensional structure determination. You have here on the left side a drawing of a polypeptide chain. Here on the left, in what we call the random coil or RC form, that is, it just shows an extended linear molecule, a chain of amino acids, that is fully accessible to the solvent, which in all body fluids is an aqueous solution. Knowledge of the linear structure that we can derive readily from the genomic information contained in DNA sequences is not enough to understand the functioning or malfunctioning in disease of proteins. What we need to know is the biologically active folded form of the protein. And you see that the linear chain has in this simple drawing been folded up into a globular form in 2 dimensions. And here on the right, I show you in more detail how this folded form of the polypeptide chain looked to X-ray crystallographers in 1960. This is one of the structures published in 1969 by a colleague of Perutz and Kendrew, and you can see that this is a very low resolution picture. That is what structural biology had to work with in the 1960s, and it was a lot of work to get such a structure. Typically, the scientists would work with a whole group of students for 10 years to obtain such a structure. Today, typically, a complete protein structure is solved in half a day or perhaps 2 days. See, until 1970, 10 structures had been solved. There are now more than 10 structures solved every day. Actually, about 50 structures are published every single day of the year. Now, 15 years later, this folded structure of a polypeptide chain would look like this, being determined either by X-ray crystallography or by NMR. Now we can see atomic resolution. And here I come back to a technical point. Here now you have spelled out what NMR stands for. NMR stands for nuclear magnetic resonance. And so, this, by the way, was the first structure that was solved with this method,
And the important point is that we now have atomic resolution. We can describe the position of each atom in the structure, and we can do this in solution and not only in single crystals. Why is this of interest? Well, functional proteins in our body are found either in the body fluids are the blood, or the stomach liquid, or saliva. All these body fluids are protein solutions. And if a protein is not dissolved in an aqueous solvent, for example, in membrane proteins, then it functions in contact with aqueous solutions of proteins. And so it is really exciting to be able to learn about such structures, functional structures of protein molecules in that state, in solution as in body fluids, in which it performs its functions in our body. Both function in health and dysfunction in disease. Now, let me next be just a little bit technical in another historical review and show to you how the progress from the low resolution structures to the high resolution structures is reflected in the NMR spectra that we could obtain from proteins. In 1970, this is the spectrum of my own hemoglobin. You see, that's a trademark, KW for Kurt-Wittrich. And this is the NMR spectrum of my blood. And you see, this looks very cheap. It's also an old slide by now, of course, but there are just very few lines that you can work with. Today, or already 20 years ago, this kind of spectrum was obtained. We now have two dimensions, two frequency dimensions. We talked about two-dimensional spectroscopy. And when we look a bit closer to this spectra, then this is the sort of information that we get. Now compare this, 1970-1985. And if we get this kind of information, then we can start to derive three-dimensional structures. And these three-dimensional structures of proteins come in different shapes. See, very different shapes, different sizes. All these computer programs that I used to make these drawings were written by my students, by the way. That's a very important part of our work. So these programs also enable to partially interpret the structural drawings. And the very important feature is that because NMR can be used in solution, we can not only see folded, rather rigid, protein molecules, but we can also see flexible parts. You see, here for example you have four snapshots of the same protein taken in time intervals of 20 picoseconds. That's 2 × 10⁻¹⁰ seconds. And you see that this part, which corresponds actually to this drawing, this globular part remains unchanged. But the tail here, is very different after these short time intervals. Now this is a very intriguing protein. This is a prion protein found in cattle. And this protein is known to have an important, but so far not specified role in the development of mad cow disease. So it is a protein structure that has obtained a lot of interest, not only scientifically, but also from the medical community and from politicians, I dare say. Now I can present this structure in a different way. I can superimpose, in this case, 20 snapshots, which now cover about 2 nanoseconds, that's now 10 to the minus 9 seconds, and during this short time frame, the tail covers very large amount of space, much more than the globular domain. And this is the sort of pictures that we get when we use NMR for studying protein structures in solution. So in addition to getting a detailed picture of the geometry of the molecule, we get information on movements of the protein. The molecules of life are really alive. There is a lot of dynamics in these structures, and over the last 20 years, mostly based on NMR investigations, it has been demonstrated in several hundred cases that such disorder in a functional protein is very important for the proper function. In the case of the prime protein, we are still searching for an answer as to what exactly it means that we have this unusually long, highly flexible tail attached to a folded domain of the protein. Now, after giving you this review of what we are doing, what structural biology is, and what tools are used in structural biology, I would like to describe to you with a particular example how we come from the basic research projects to work that may directly affect our life quality. And for this illustration, I have chosen a study with a drug molecule. That drug molecule has the scientific name cyclosporine A. It is a small polypeptide. It's a cyclic undecapeptide. Now cyclosporine also has a trade name. It is sold under the trade name of Sandimmune. And that trade name indicates what its function is. It is used in human medicine to suppress organ rejection after transplantation. So each patient who has had a kidney transplant or a heart transplant or any other transplant will have to eat cyclosporine A, probably in combination with one or two other drugs, for the rest of his life. It had been known before we started to work on this project that cyclosporine binds to a small intracellular protein which is a receptor for its primary receptor. So what was known before work on in structural biology started was that there is a protein and there is a drug, and somehow these two interact. Now, when we solve the structure of the complex of cyclophilin with the drug molecule cyclosporine A, they form a one-to-one complex, then we get this picture. And now, of course, we have much more information than we used to have before. Now we know what the shape is of the receptor molecule. We know where and with which part of its surface the drug molecule is in contact with the receptor. And I can illustrate to you what this means. This means we can now study the folding of the polypeptide chain in this receptor molecule. You see, here's the blue lines indicate a beta sheet structure. The red lines are two so-called alpha helical secondary structures, and then there is non-regular secondary structure of the protein. What you can probably guess from looking at this is that this binding site for the drug is in here, on top of this helix. It is around here. Now, what I can also do, in addition to studying the way the polypeptide chain is folded inside, is that I can draw all the side chains of the amino acid of the polypeptide chain and draw the surface of the molecule after taking the drug molecule away. This I can do, for example, with a computer. Or we have also studied the structure without the drug part. And then here, the light bluish parts of the molecule do not interact with the drug, but all those atoms that are called brown or green are in contact with the drug. And now we are getting into business, because each drug molecule that has good effects, as in this case, suppressing the immune repression of a transplanted organ, usually also has negative effects. It may be harmful for the kidneys, it may be a heavy load for the liver, or for some other organ in the human body. And so we have to find a balance between the positive action of the drug and the side effects that may be less desirable. And because we are always in this sort of weighing advantages and disadvantages, we always work on these drug molecules. We try to change their chemical structure in the hope of improving their positive function, so that the dosage could be reduced, or by eliminating some negative side effects. But now, when we see in detail how the area looks into which the drug molecule is received by the receptor, then we can start to plan how we might want to change the chemistry of the molecule in order so that it gets better into this binding site. On the other end, I can of course take the drug molecule and look at it when it sits in here. Now in this particular case, the only structural information available before we got into the picture was the crystal structure obtained after crystallizing this cyclic undecapeptide from chloroform. And in this crystal structure, it is a very hydrophobic structure which could not undergo any recognition as an hydrogen bond donor. Now it actually turned out that when we got the structure of the drug molecule when it's bound to the receptor, it's completely changed. It's like you don't use gloves here. So talking about the glove is not a good comparison because it's a warm climate. Let me just say the drug molecule was turned inside out. But now we have a number of hydrogen bonding functions, especially amide groups and H groups, which now interact by hydrogen bonding with this receptor site. Now, this of course was an immediate cause for the chemists to change strategy. They would bridge the cyclic peptide here in order to enforce it to have the active receptor bond form also before it is bound to the receptor. This should lead possibly to reduction of the dosage to get the same effects and so on. And then in the end, you can put the drug molecule back into its receptor site and can again look at the complete structure and evaluate whether by the planned or perhaps executed changes in the chemistry of the drug we have achieved something positive. In the end, this will of course only come out of trials with patients. Now, I'm talking here in a program of bridges towards a conversation of peace, if I read this correctly from here. Anyway, peace, politics, bridges, conversation. What can such biomedical research have to do with politics and peace? Let me give you a few examples. Tuberculosis has not been an attractive disease for big pharma companies because not much money was to be made. And so tuberculosis has been neglected in careful treatment, and today tuberculosis is one of the big threats of mankind, especially in third world countries. Now, it is with regard to, not just for emotional reasons, but for political reasons and reasons towards establishing peace, it is important that research on tuberculosis and search for new medication to fight tuberculosis is taken up again. A similar disease that has been largely neglected, and that's, as far as I know, endemic also in Thailand, is the dengue fever. There is no cure for dengue fever. There is hardly a reliable diagnosis for dengue fever, and it is important for a peaceful collaboration in developing and developed countries that research projects on dengue fever are activated. I have just visited a non-profit institution in Singapore who is here at exclusively studying new ways to fight tuberculosis and dengue fever. So this is a very encouraging initiative toward better politics and hopefully towards evolutions that will lead to peaceful cohabitation of developing countries with the high-tech part of today's world. On the 10th of December, that is 3 days ago, Mrs. Wangari Maathai from Kenya was awarded the Peace Nobel Prize. During her speeches before getting the prize and after getting the prize, she suggested that AIDS was an invention by Western scientists who created the AIDS virus to eradicate the black race. She has taken several months to explain what she really means. And I think when we talk about politics and peaceful cohabitation of the humankind around the world, it is very difficult to accept such discussions on issues of health and politics. I would also want to mention an excerpt from an article that I have just read on the airplane that's taken from Chemical and Engineering News. And what it says is that in the development of new drugs, the search for new drugs, the big international pharmaceutical companies are looking for partnerships all over the world. And that includes partnerships with startup companies in developing countries, especially when it comes to fighting diseases that are endemic in climates such as the tropical belt and similar, and that are not directly of concern in the Western countries. Roche, one of the big Swiss companies alone, has entertained more than 1,600 partnerships in 2003. I expect that there will be more than 3,000 new partnerships created in 2004. And this leaves plenty of room for partnerships with newly founded research groups all around the world, including developing countries, including Thailand. I think today the general philosophy of big pharma is one of outsourcing a lot of their basic work and then selecting from a large number of partnerships those that would be successful for them, and that gives important impetus, I would say, for creating new science, biomedical science initiatives all around the world, not only on the US West Coast and around Boston, but also in the areas closer to the equator. These are just a few ideas on what sort of links one might find from talking about biomedical research and the main theme of the series of Bridges events. I would like to mention yet another practical application which is of utmost importance in a similar way as medical care in large areas of the world, and that is agriculture and food supply. And I've just read in the Nation, I mean your newspaper of yesterday, that there is a big discussion going on about introduction of research on genetically modified food for Thailand. And I can assure you that the same discussion is going on in our country, in Switzerland. The same discussion is going on in the United States. And we have votes in the country about whether or not to allow genetic modification of foodstuff. And I think this is an area where all countries around the globe, high-tech and becoming high-tech yet, have to collaborate and come to solutions of these hanging problems. And of course, in contrast to the situation in the Western and Northern countries, the issue at stake here is also to fight malnutrition, and I think it is a very big issue how we will politically, an issue for politics and for peace, how we will politically treat the issue of genetic manipulation of our foodstuff. Now, with this, I would like to conclude for a few, to change my theme for a few minutes and stop talking about the sort of science that we do, but rather entertain a few moments of my life and my career to give you an impression of how I came about to work in the area that I have just described to you.
Let me first say a few words about how I grew up. I grew up in this farmhouse, and there were many things with me to say. There were animals, there were plants, but for my lifestyle, actually, it was most important that there was a trout river. Oh well, a river where we would grow fish. And when I was a boy, I was in charge of this river. I had to look after the fish. This has helped me to feed my family for many years. See, this is a bunch of trout taken in Patagonia, in the south it was in Chile, I think, in the lake, very high up. And then I learned something very important for my scientific career early on, because of my fishing experience. I learned that I had to, you see, if I caught just nice-sized trout, I could feed myself and have a nice meal. But if I wanted to get attention from important people means the tall people, I had to get big fish. And that's a very good lesson for professional life. If you search, if you think carefully about what you do before you start doing it, and you focus on a big fish, you may get much more rewards than if you spend the same amount of effort and time going after small fish. Well, the next phase in my life was that I went to sports school. Yes, you should change. Now your technical capabilities are up. Okay, I think the problem will be resolved. Anyway, on this side, I was shown exercising high jumping. Well, and then in sports from the University of Basel. And this included playing soccer, and you see I continued to play soccer for quite some years. That's from last year actually. Then I can do some advertisement for Switzerland as a tourism country. Here you see the Jungfrau Mountain and in this area we would do ski racing, okay? With chemistry support, the CBASF sponsoring the Lauterhorn Slalom in this case. There is also a downhill race. Now, what does this have to do with Thailand? I read The Nation yesterday, and I read here, government looks to a sportier Thailand. That was in yesterday's issue of the journal. It says that the government envisages a major revolution in fostering physical education in Thailand. Among others, the first thing is they give 4 points how they want to achieve this. The first point is upgrade the basic level of physical education in all schools. I don't know how much physical activities are required of you during studies. I hope it is a lot, in spite of the hot climate. The second point involves channeling the government budget into providing adequate sports facilities. I wish you lots of fun already on the new tennis courts football fields and so likes. Point three is aimed at securing creative future success vis-a-vis Olympic medals. I only turned to science when I had to give up hope to get an Olympic medal. And the final point covers way of promoting professional careers in sports to help promising athletes pursue their dreams. And I hope that the government will have adequate funds not only to help 50 sports people to fulfill their dreams, but and I am very encouraged by what I have seen here today in the university also puts means at, on the table to enable young scientists to fulfill their dreams. And I can only hope that many of you will take this chance and make use of the opportunities that are now opening up for young people to embark on a scientific career in this country. And of course, when I come back to bridges, sports has always been a bridge to overcome the differences in opinion. Very often, sports encounters were the first common activities between long-standing differences between countries. You may remember that the first contacts between China and the United States was a famous table tennis match, and there are many such occasions where first the East German and West Germans got together to play football against each other and then basketball and so on, and the politicians came later on and the discussion started after there had been joint sports activities. So I think this is another theme that fits perfectly well under the general heading of what Bridges wants to achieve with its events here in Thailand. Finally, I would also want to mention that my career involved extensive work outside of my home country. This was on the one hand in the United States, seeing new conditions for research, different from Switzerland, with a lot of activities in Japan, which means I have spent at least 10 years of my life in the United States, at least 2 years in Japan, and I have spent a lot of time in many other countries in Asia, in Latin America, in New Zealand, and in Africa, everywhere, working, for example, for ICSU, for UNESCO, in organizing schools on science and getting involved on with international contacts. Again, in many cases, science, just as sports, has been the first way to make contacts between countries that did not otherwise talk to each other. I have lived through several instances where a long silence between countries that did not speak to each other was started through sports, followed by science, followed by the politicians. This then brings me to the end of my presentation. I would like to summarize again what I have try to get across to you in the first scientific part of my lecture. I have talked to you about three dimensions. I should say a few words on how we obtain these structures. We have to sit in a high-tech environment. I'm sitting here on an NMR machine. The most important thing is to have well-educated young scientists around as a team. I always work with a team about the size of a football team with replacements. That's about 20 people at any given time. See, here you have about 250 names of those who worked with me during the period from 1970 to 2002. So people, well-educated people are the most important ingredients for doing good research. Then of course we need some equipment here. Our 900 megahertz magnet is unloaded from a truck to be installed in, this is the most powerful NMR machine that's presently available. So we need heavy equipment. This also needs some monetary investment. I'm very glad that I have seen a very modern NMR equipment here today in your university, in the chemistry department. Then we need to do a lot of theory. My work is largely based on theoretical physics, although we always talk biology and biomedicine, but I like theoretical physics, and two-thirds of all my graduate students have been physicists over the years. And you see here, for example, by studying the time evolution of single transition basis operators in multiple nuclear spin systems located in large proteins, we were able to find out ways to apply NMR methodology not only to small molecules, which we would study. You see, these experiments then turn into trade names. I mean, out of such equations come POSI, NOSI, ZEXI, FOXI, but most recently DROSI. And each one of these names hides some very complicated expression. DROSI is transverse relaxation optimized spectroscopy. Actually, DROSI is exactly what we got out of these equations here, and it enabled us to extend the technique of NMR from studying small proteins to very large proteins. We are now capable of studying not only smallish proteins like this one, but to actually get membrane proteins out of the biological membranes and reconstitute them in mixed micelles in solution. And thanks to these equations that we have seen here, and the resulting DROSI technique, we are now capable to do structure determinations also of membrane proteins, which represents the biggest gap today in the goals that we want to achieve in structural genomics. So in all today, I have tried to introduce to you the kind of work we are doing, indicate some ways in which this work relates to applications that can improve the quality of life of all of us. I have then also tried to indicate to you how I came into doing this sort of research, and how we work, what the environment is. You will have recognized that this environment that is needed for the kind of work I have described to you is being established here in your university, and I think all over this area. And I can only hope that many of you will embark on a career in science and find new ways to provide new pictures of not only the molecules of life, but their interactions, their interplay, and that you may not only enrich your own life by pursuing this kind of work, but actually in the end be able to contribute in some ways to further improvement of the quality of life here and elsewhere. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much for this incredible talk. It was very enlightening and stimulating lecture. Now it's time for questions and answers. You can ask in English or in Thai. If the question is in Thai, then Professor Biyo, who is sitting over there, will kindly help us with the translation of the question and answers. So please, there is one microphone there and one here, and also one twice.
Now that NMR has proven to be very powerful and very rapid, how does it compare with X-ray crystallography? Are there many more advantages nowadays with NMR and crystallography?
Well, the two methods are highly complementary. You see, you cannot learn about the behavior of proteins in solution by solving crystal structure. That's not the direct way. On the other hand, we cannot solve de novo very big structures. It's just too expensive. We could today, but it's too expensive. I mean, X-ray crystallography today is more efficient once you get crystals. But if you don't get crystals, NMR is the only method. So you see, you want to have both. And you want to use in each particular project, you want to use that method that can give the desired results and that can provide the results in the most economic way. I give you an example. In California, I'm involved in structural genomics, which also means high throughput pipelines for protein production. Today, each protein that comes through this pipeline is screened with NMR. On the basis of the NMR spectra, we advise the crystallographers about whether or not the chances are good that they can get crystals. They try to get crystals with those proteins that we recommend to them. If they don't get good crystals, the proteins come back to us to do the structure. Otherwise, the structure is done by crystallography. You see, we do the structure determination only when the crystallographers can do it, which is reasonable for economic reasons. But they select their targets based on our evaluation from cheap NMR experiments at one stage during the protein production pipeline. Does that answer your question? Okay.
You mentioned the picosecond, dynamic protein folding. Can it go any faster than that? Nowadays, you see the whole process of folding from out and random color to secondary structure and on.
Well, that depends on the case. There are proteins that fold quite rapidly. And it's not fully understood why they can fold so rapidly. There are others where you have, for example, some slow processes on the way to the final fold, such as cis trans isomerization of proline peptide bonds and similar, and then you come to folding times of milliseconds to seconds. I think there is a big variety in terms of folding. And then of course this only, what I'm talking about now in response to your answer, is only based on in vitro experiments. It reflects what happens on the influence of chaperones in the living cell.
Can I have a couple of questions? First of all, I see that the NMR is moving up 500, 600, 700, 900. Is this trend going to continue? Or are we going to reach a limit where it is no longer, it gives better resolution?
work is in progress to produce. I mean, there is already a magnet in Japan that works at 930 megahertz. Okay? That's one clear answer. There is work in progress to produce 1,000 megahertz, 1 gigahertz NMR magnet. This will be a very big machine. Very big. I mean, it will probably not be practical to install such a machine in an individual laboratory. It's a Drozd effect, which has opened the door to doing big structures. It has an optimum at around 950 megahertz. Then there's a curve that turns around. And so there is no obvious reason at this point to go to much higher field. I foresee that to go to really more powerful NMR machines, one would have to give up the idea of producing those magnets in some factory and then disassembling them, transporting them to a client and re-energize. I think you have to forget about this. If you start to construct a magnet fixed at the place where it's going, in the center where it's going to function, I could imagine that one would end up with magnets that have the necessary continuity to be useful for NMR, and that are maybe 30 or 40% higher field than what we have today. What it will bring, I cannot predict with certainty. So far, whenever we got to a higher magnetic field, we had a very clear cut advantage.
Thank you very much. Could you just comment one thing? You talked about structural genomics, and I think some of the people here are the more general audience, so could you say what the goals of the structural genomics are?
In structural genomics, we are talking about the new way of using the tools of structural biology. On the one hand, structural genomics involves to improve those tools. We talk about high throughput structure determination. We want to do thousands and thousands of structures in order to determine all possible protein folds, so that we could in the end predict all those missing folds from homology considerations. This was the original stated goal of structural genomics. Where are we with this? It is so that maybe 1,000 or 1,500 structures have been solved by the structural genomics initiatives. But most of these are not the most interesting structures. And most of all, there are very few membrane protein structures. We now have about 30,000 structures in the data bank, and only about 50 are membrane protein structures. On the other hand, genomic analysis indicates that 30% of all proteins will be membrane proteins. So you see, there's a huge gap. It seems less and less practical to work full steam on this originally stated goal of structural genomics. I would never have entered that field myself just to improve the techniques of NMR or protein production or crystallography or high throughput procedures.
For me, the excitement is in a very different order of the game. You see, someone who has been in structural biology for many years, as I have, is used to obtain a structure, a three-dimensional protein structure, very late in a research project. I mean, a typical example is hemoglobin. A hemoglobin is a red protein in our blood, and it was the first protein for which the structure was solved. Now, before that structure was solved, it has been known that hemoglobin binds oxygen. It has been known that there is cooperativity of oxygen binding. A lot of things that it was known that there was a so-called pore effect, that is a pH dependence of the oxygen binding. All this had been known, and then finally the structure was determined, the structure was used to explain the known functions of the protein. Now, in structural genomics, things are completely different. What we start with is the information on the DNA sequence and the genome. Now, in the DNA sequence of the genome, for example, the human genome, only 20% of the genes have known or suspected biological functions attached. For 80% of the annotated genes, we don't know what function they represent. Now we can, on the other hand, we can now take these genes, introduce them into E. coli bacteria, and produce the gene product, the protein. There's no sweat. We can do this by the dozen, by the hundreds. And then we can determine the X-ray structure or the NMR structure. And then we have these nice pictures. Actually, two of the structures I showed come out of a structural genomics project, and we don't know what they do. So now we have the structure, and everybody expects us to predict what the function should be. But that, of course, is a very much different task to rationalizing a known function with a three-dimensional structure. See, and that's where we are now. And this work is not successful yet. We get more and more structures and very few examples where the structure would lead to a new function. And this is the excitement in structural genomics. And that's why I am in structural genomics. And I'm just looking forward what will happen. And I want to be in the game when we find better ways to go from structure to unknown functions. That's maybe how I could summarize what structural genomics is from my point of view.
I think on behalf of the audience, thank you, science, of course. I'd like to thank Professor Lewis very much. I think we have learned a lot from this lecture, not only anymore how powerful this machine is, how big it will get, protein structure that is discovered through this NMR become more complex, not only soluble protein now, it's become membrane-bound protein as well that will be elucidated through NMR. We certainly learned a lot, and thank his talk. We can go back tonight and start thinking about what we have been talking. Perhaps you would come up with some new ideas and hopefully lead to your future development discovery in the future. Not only chemistry that we learn, I think we also learn that Professor Burris can ride horses. He skied also. I think he was skiing for 1.5 years somewhere. Is that correct in your report of continuous?
Well, when we solved the structure, that it eventually
resulted in my getting the Nobel Prize. I was happy that I left Zohar and I went skiing for 2 years.
So, before you go to the beach for 2 years, and you do something as good as you. So, and
I don't forget, teaching skiing was my profession before I did science. I was just going back to my former job.
And we also witnessed that he is a sport lover, and he really likes sports, and I think a very complete person. I think he's a person who we should exemplify and look at as an example, one who loves nature, one who likes sports, and one who also, of course, doing science well. As I went through his bibliography, this one thing that I mentioned to Azu for and perhaps I think we could learn a lot. It says in your bibliography that you want to know something about NMR. So you start writing a book about it. Is that correct?
Yes.
See, this is, could you tell us a little bit more? It seems as if when we know so much about a field, we start writing books. But you said you want to know more about NMR, that's why you're writing a textbook about it.
Yes. That's the same when you teach. As you may have experienced yourself, you learn much more than students when you teach. They'll ask you some nasty questions that will give you new ideas. And you have to prepare yourself to give the lecture, just as you have to prepare yourself to write the book. And then it has a purpose. I mean, to learn all this stuff without doing anything with it, it just isn't appealing. But if you set yourself as a goal to write the book, then you know what you work for. The same when you go in front of the students and teach, then you have a motivation to work through a lot of stuff that you would otherwise pass in production.
So when one really want to know something about something, write a book about it. So with that, have an audience, and I'd like to thank Professor Burris very much for this very enlightening lecture. And of course, we thank the International Peace Foundation and Iskcon Thai Bank for hosting this seminar. So everybody is invited for coffee and tea outside. Johnny, again, in giving Professor Burris a big hand. Thank you very much.